Guten Abend, meine Damen und Herren. Ich freue mich, Sie zum Vortrag von Maria Mavroudi begrüßen zu dürfen. Und weil Maria so gut Deutsch spricht, werde ich sie auf Deutsch einführen. I beg the fellows who do not understand German for their patience. The introduction is going to be short and they don't need an introduction in the first place because, of course, they know Maria. Maria Mavroudi ist Byzantinistin und lehrt seit 2002 an der University Berkeley, mit Ausnahme von 2 Jahren, wo sie an die Ostküste nach Princeton gewechselt ist und dann schnell wieder zurück. Geboren ist sie allerdings in Thessaloniki. Sie ist also nicht nur Byzantinistin, sondern darüber hinaus gebürtige Byzantinerin. Und verhält sich nicht selten als byzantinische Patriotin, allerdings nicht aus politischen, sondern aus sehr guten wissenschaftlichen Gründen, was vielleicht auch heute Abend deutlich werden wird in dem Vortrag. In Thessaloniki hat sie ihren ersten Abschluss, den BA in Classics, gemacht. Allerdings ist Classics in Griechenland an griechischen Universitäten, nicht nur an griechischen Universitäten, sondern weltweit, im Wesentlichen auf die Epochen vor der römischen Kaiserzeit fokussiert, das heißt auf das archaische, klassische und hellenistische Griechenland. Maria aber hatte, wie sie mir erzählt hat, gegen Ende ihrer Schulzeit von ihren Eltern ein Mofa geschenkt bekommen. Und mit Hilfe dieses Mofas erkundete sie die Stadt und stieß, das lässt sich in Thessaloniki kaum vermeiden, immer wieder auf Bauwerke und Monumente der Spätantike aus einer Zeit, die in ihrem BA-Studium gar nicht vorkam. Gerade dieses Nichtvorkommen machte sie neugierig. Und sie beschloss natürlich, sich damit näher zu beschäftigen. Das ist ein Leitmotiv, das mir für die ganze wissenschaftliche Arbeit von Maria bezeichnend zu sein scheint. Jede Disziplin hat einen Horizont. Maria interessiert sich ganz besonders für das, was jenseits vom Horizont liegt. Also segelte sie nach dem BA erstmal über den Atlantischen Ozean und setzte ihre Studien in Harvard fort. Aber auch hier gab es einen Horizont und damit eine Welt jenseits davon. Maria interessierte sich vor allem für die Wechselwirkung zwischen der byzantinischen und der islamisch geprägten arabischen Kultur, also lernte sie Arabisch. Den Sommer 1992 verbrachte sie zu diesem Zweck an der American University in Kairo. Und mit dieser Doppelkompetenz gehört Maria Mavroudi zu einer ziemlich kleinen Schar von Wissenschaftlern, die sowohl griechische als auch arabische Quellen zu lesen imstande sind. Das ist ein ziemlich exklusiver Club. Man bräuchte eigentlich mehr davon, aber es gibt nicht viele. 1998 wurde sie promoviert mit einer Untersuchung über ein byzantinisches Lehrbuch der Trauminterpretation aus dem 10. Jahrhundert, das seinerseits auf arabische Quellen zurückgreift und dieser ganze Komplex kommt in diesem einigermaßen dicken Buch vor. Auch diese Themenwahl, Trauminterpretation, scheint mir bezeichnend. Byzantinisten befassen sich in der Regel mit allen möglichen literarischen Quellen, mit historischen, theologischen und philosophischen Texten, aber selten mit Wissenschaftsgeschichte. Und umgekehrt beschäftigen sich Wissenschaftshistoriker selten mit Byzanz. Aber noch seltener beschäftigen sich Byzantinisten, wie mir scheint, mit der Geschichte okkulter Wissenschaften. Hans-Georg Beck, ein illustrer Vertreter dieses Faches, wunderte sich einmal in einem Handbuch, das bis heute ein Standardwerk geblieben ist, dass die Byzantiner sich bis in höchste Kreise hinein mit, ich zitiere, Mantik und zauberischem Krimskrams, Zitat Ende, beschäftigten. Und das ist genau dieser Krimskrams, der es Maria besonders angetan hat. Allerdings ergibt sich ihr wissenschaftliches Interesse aus einem sehr präzisen intellektuellen Problem. Es geht darum, dass die Demarkationslinie zwischen sogenannt rationaler und okkulter Wissenschaften keineswegs unproblematisch ist. Die Grenze verschiebt sich vielmehr im Lauf der Geschichte und ihr Verlauf muss immer wieder neu ausgehandelt werden und wird auch neu ausgehandelt. Das, was uns heute als rationale Wissenschaft gilt, war nicht immer rationale Wissenschaft. Die Verhandlungen, wo die Grenze genau verläuft, erlauben interessante Einblicke in das intellektuelle Klima einer Kultur. Und das erfordert allerdings, dass man die Unterscheidung zwischen seriöser Wissenschaft und Krimskrams erst einmal nicht als gegeben betrachtet, dass man mit einem Fuß diesseits und mit dem anderen Fuß sich jenseits der Grenze positioniert, dass man mit anderen Worten den Grenzverlauf selbst zum Gegenstand seiner, in diesem Fall ihrer, Untersuchung macht. Es überrascht unter diesen Umständen nicht, dass Maria es in ihrer Forschung oft genug mit unpublizierten Texten zu tun hat, die erst einmal ediert werden müssen. Sie ist tatsächlich mit allen Wassern ihres Faches, eigentlich müsste man sagen ihrer Fächer, gewaschen, von der Paläographie bis zu Methoden der Textinterpretation. Auch das ist nicht ganz häufig. Ebenso wenig überraschend ist es, dass sie sich dabei selten auf ausgetretenen Wegen bewegt. Sie liebt es, neue Schneisen ins Dickicht zu schlagen. Die meisten byzantinischen Autoren, mit denen sie sich beschäftigt hat und beschäftigt, waren mir zum Beispiel vorher nicht einmal dem Namen nach bekannt. Es ist ein versunkener Kontinent, den sie wieder ans Tageslicht bringt. Das geschieht mit unerhörter Gelehrsamkeit, aber zugleich, und das scheint mir ebenso bezeichnend wie singulär, mit einer unerhörten Klarheit. Wenn man Marias Texte liest, folgt man ihr durch einen unbekannten Wald, in dem man ohne ihre Hilfe sofort und einigermaßen rettungslos verloren wäre. Dennoch verliert man beim Lesen vor lauter Bäumen niemals den Wald selbst aus den Augen. Bei aller Gelehrsamkeit und bei allem Interesse für das Okkulte geht es bei Maria fast immer um sehr große, einfache und zentrale Fragen. Man weiß als Leser immer, wonach sie in diesem Wald sucht und welche Ziele sie vor Augen hat. Und man kann auch einigermaßen sicher sein, dass sie diese Ziele erreicht. Heute Abend geht es nun nicht um okkulte Wissenschaft, sondern um Homer und Homer-Rezeption. Das klingt nach einem einigermaßen vertrauten Thema, zumindest für Altertumswissenschaftler. Aber es würde mich wundern, wenn es dabei bliebe. Denn es wird um Homer-Rezeption aus byzantinischer Perspektive gehen und damit um ein Phänomen, über das die wenigsten klassischen Philologen nachgedacht haben dürften. Ich rechne damit, dass Maria uns auch heute Abend in einen unbekannten Wald hinein und ziemlich sicher auch wieder herausführen wird. Maria, the floor is yours.
I thank you all for coming, especially on a wet day. And I'm very glad to see my friends, my fellows, and also good colleagues from within the Byzantine field. I apologize to them if I say things that are extremely well known to them, but I feel I need to orient the rest of my Zuhörer tonight. And I will first use a series of maps to tell a political history of the Byzantine Empire. And as I do this, I will try to explain how my understanding of Byzantine intellectual history fits within this larger political history. And then I will try to take us to the reception of Homer in the medieval period in the Middle East and the Slavic world, and then explain a gradual rupture from the 15th century onwards that becomes radical only in the 19th. And it is this 19th century spectrum that leads us into what we think about Homer, which is entirely different from what the Byzantines thought. But I think it's important to know what the Byzantines thought because of our entire reconsideration of antiquity that the Western civilization has for so long understood as its cornerstone, a cornerstone of its modern identity. And this is something that we are in need, we need to revise it because of how we think about what Western identity is and what colonialism is and what imperial visions of the 19th and 20th century have been, for which we feel guilty or uncomfortable, which create political or demographic problems in the countries in Europe, in the United States, et cetera, et cetera. So the so back to the 4th century. Byzantine is the period of the Roman Empire, during which the Roman Empire was Christian, and in particular, the period during which the capital, Constantinople, was in Christian hands. The first Byzantine emperor, by my reckoning, there are other periodizations that are possible too, is Emperor Constantine, who moved the imperial capital from Rome to Constantinople in 330, and then inaugurated the period whereby Constantinople remained the capital of the Roman Empire until 1453, when it was taken by the Ottoman Turks. In deference to modern sensibilities, I will call Constantinople Constantinople up to 1453. I'll start calling it Istanbul afterwards. But for now, we are still in Constantinople. And I say that this is the Roman Empire because this is also how the Byzantines themselves understood themselves to be. They thought of themselves as Roman, and also their eastern neighbors, the Arabs, called them Rum, which is, again, Romans, and this remains a name in Turkish and in Arabic to refer to the Greek Orthodox religious denomination. So it is an identity that has its roots in the Byzantine period and requires the Byzantine period to be understood. As we said, Constantine moved the capital from Rome to Constantinople, and there followed a series of emperors. By this time, the empire had become extremely large to govern single-handedly. Already his predecessor, Diocletian, had created a college of four emperors, unprecedented, somebody willing to share imperial power. He changed capitals, he was an itinerant emperor. And already under him, he lived for a while in Nicomedia, in the eastern, you see it on the map there, at the eastern side. The eastern side in general was deemed as more important by the Roman emperors because it was more heavily populated, therefore it could be taxed better, therefore it gave more income. Another important aspect was that it was threatened by the more organized enemy and the older enemy, therefore the more respected enemy, and this was the Sasanian Empire, the Persians. In the west it was, I will refer to them, I know it's not politically correct, but is a reference tonight, the barbarians. So as the barbarians keep coming in from the 4th into the 5th century, the western part is allowed to fall into their hands. The last emperor that holds the title of Roman emperor is Romulus Augustulus, around 475. And I'm trying to move forward here. This is more or less what the empire begins to look like around the year 500. So I want you to remember that there is no Roman emperor in the West around the year 500, and the title is reinvented when Charlemagne crowns himself emperor in 800. It is revived. Homer becomes important in this context for genealogical reasons, the Romans are viewed as descending from Aeneas, who is a Trojan, and Aeneas leaves Troy because the Greeks came in, besieged it, and destroyed it. So the Trojan narrative becomes important in order to shape a Western Latin identity as opposed to a Greek-speaking Roman identity. So from Charlemagne onwards, we have two empires, the Byzantine and the Carolingian, vying for the same title of Roman Empire. And of course, the Roman Empire understands itself as universal, notionally ruling all over the world. So they are faced with the impossibility of having two Roman emperors. This is impossible. So they each try to delegitimize the other. And for this reason, the Trojan narrative becomes important, and retellings of the Trojan narrative. So because Virgil, who had put what happens after the end of Troy into Latin epic verse, was read, kept being read in the Middle Ages, but already in antiquity there circulated other variants of the Trojan epic, and some of them had also been translated into Latin. So this is not a story that has a single plot, but there are many different Homeric plots, rival Homeric plots, that are used in particular contexts of legitimization of royal or aristocratic power, because they have to do with ancestry to Aeneas in the Latin West, or other Trojan heroes. It's something that one can play with. The Trojan narratives, their best articulation in this context is found in the medieval World Chronicles. This is something of a textbook. It was something used in kind of the equivalent of medieval middle school education, because they offered an understanding of world history like we do in middle school and high school today. And of course, like we do in middle school and high school today, it was meant to convey a sense of collective identity that was politically useful. The grandfather of the intellectual grandfather of the Christian World Chronicle was a court historian to Constantine the Great. His name was Eusebius, and his the way he footprinted the Christian World Chronicle for Greek, Latin, and other Christian languages in the Middle Ages was a triumphal march from paganism to Christianity and to salvation. So it is the triumphal march of through history of the group of Christians. And of course, different groups of Christians understood Eusebius in different ways. For Eusebius, the Trojan War was an important, as it was for pagan ancient historians, was an important terminus around which to peg world history. And for this reason, in Eusebius and also in other medieval narratives, having a Trojan narrative that did not necessarily conform with what Homer said was absolutely paramount. And in different rival world chronicles of the Christian world, we find different details. For example, in Armenia, that became Christian in the 4th century, we have a Trojan narrative in Moses Horanetsi's chronicle, which is probably written around in the 8th century. I mean, there's a chronological problem there that I won't analyze, but let's say it is a product from between the 6th and the 8th century. And he follows Eusebius in saying that there was an Ethiopian army that was allied with King Priam of Troy. And the leader of this, and this exists in Eusebius. Eusebius gives us something like that. The detail that Moses Horanetsi adds is that the leader of this Ethiopian army was an Armenian, and he gives his name, and this is unheard of. What can one make politically out of such an unusual narrative? Well, in the 6th century, the Council of Chalcedon had taken place. Excuse me, in the 5th century, the Council of Chalcedon had taken place that had defined what was Byzantine Christian orthodoxy, and that had condemned forms of Christianity that existed in the eastern frontier, and this included Ethiopia and it included Armenia. And it's politically incorrect to call it that, but I will call it monophysitism. When Moses Horanetsi, within 2 centuries after this fact, mentions the Trojans as the Ethiopians and the Armenians as enemies of the Greeks, it really speaks to a contemporary political reality. As we move on in time, the dream of a universal, leaving now World Chronicles, going back to political history, the dream of a universal Roman Empire, in spite of the fall of the Western part in the 5th century that I described briefly, remained true. and was revived in the 6th century by perhaps the most famous Byzantine emperor among lay people. This is Emperor Justinian. So Justinian embarked in an extensive war of reconquest to recover the western part of the Mediterranean. And this is what the empire looked like at around his time after his war of reconquest. And this started being eaten up little by little. And in the 7th century, I skipped a slide, I think I should go back to it. So there was, I should have mentioned the Sasanian Empire in a little bit more detail. So this is the organized enemy, the ancient enemy, the one that threatens the eastern part. It is very extensive. But what happens in the 7th century is that both empires, one gets completely swallowed up by the Muslim armies that come out of the Arabian Peninsula after the rise of Islam. And the Sasanian Empire is completely taken over. The Byzantine Empire loses substantial territories, primarily Syria and Egypt, as well as parts of what Justinian had reconquered. I'm not going to go in detail into that story. The result is the formation of a Muslim empire over what at the beginning is a demographically mixed population. It is not up until the end of the 9th, 10th century. Historians think it was not a Muslim majority that existed in most of the conquered countries. And also it is a very multi, like all empires, the Byzantine Empire included, you cannot have an empire unless it is multilingual. So this is the case there too. And an important part in, I will keep this for later, I don't want to confuse the narrative now. So this is a, after the conquest of the Islamic conquest of the 7th century, between the 7th and the 9th, a traditional narrative of both Byzantine and European history is that the intellectual universe of this geography is plunged into darkness. There is fewer written sources that survive from this period, both in Latin and in Greek. And we think that older historiography used to think that this is the result of the Muslim conquest that brings about the end of antiquity. Part of the end of antiquity is the erosion of urban civilization and also educational institutions that had been in place until the 6th or the early 7th century. We no longer think exactly that, but on this narrative is of political history and economic history is predicated an older narrative of intellectual history that I will now offer. It is an understanding of the progress or the transfer of science and philosophy. The sciences are supposed to have been born in the ancient Near East and in Egypt. And then they were brought from there into the Greek-speaking world that enriched them with their theoretical background in philosophy. And the Romans who came into the Greek-speaking world adopted this Hellenic construction. They respected it, they loved it, they adopted it, it's theirs, they made it flourish further. And everything was fine until more or less the end of the reign of Justinian in the 6th century. And a decline started soon afterwards to be finished with the Islamic conquests of the 7th century. However, as philosophy and science were about to be extinguished from the world at all, just in the nick of time, the Islamic world rescued them. A central event in this rescue is understood to be the Greek into Arabic translation movement that took place in 9th and 10th century Baghdad, sometime via a Syriac intermediary. So this is a massive translation of Greek philosophical and scientific texts, sometimes through a Syriac intermediary into Arabic. And so the Islamic world received this Greco-Roman substratum, developed it and made it flourish further until at most the end of the 11th century when the Islamic world is supposed to begin its decline. And Just in the nick of time, again, there is a rescuer. It is medieval Europe that from the 12th century onward starts a program of translating originally Greek material, usually through Arabic intermediaries, into Latin. What gets forgotten in this picture, although it is very well known, and at least since the beginning of the 19th century, is that exactly during the 12th century, there is also translations of originally, let's say, Aristotle and other philosophical material, etc., directly from Greek into Latin. So this narrative that I'm giving you now, although it is dominant, does not account for this side of the equation. And final repatriation of Greek scientific and philosophical material happened to the medieval, but no longer medieval, West, happens in the 15th century when Byzantine intellectuals fleeing from the advance of the Ottomans arrive in Italy and elsewhere in Europe and bring with them, the narrative emphasizes, manuscripts of the ancient authors that then the Europeans can read. Of course, they learn Greek with the aid of Byzantine intellectuals. And so they can rebaptize themselves in the clear waters of Hellenic wisdom and start becoming modern. And so this is a narrative that was dominant until the middle of the 20th century. It has very obvious implications about offering the theoretical foundations or the political theory to justify colonialism, which is the political reality of the time that it emerges. It is no longer believed. Different disciplines have dismantled bits and pieces of this narrative. That's why I could refer to it as a joke. So we no longer believe, for example, that the Islamic world begins to decline in the 12th century. People in history of science have brought examples whereby very important concepts are developed after the 12th century. Byzantinists and Western medievalists no longer believe that the 7th to the 9th century period was as dark as previously said. They, in fact, have focused on continuities between late antiquity and into the 10th century. But there is no narrative that has emerged to take its place. And within it, I think within this need to square what we think we know about Homer's Byzantine reception and what the new political narrative suggests that we should think of Homer's Byzantine reception was, I'm trying to offer that and then help revise the narrative more broadly. We are now in the 10th century. This is the height of the Greek into Arabic translation movement. And the Byzantine Empire is making a comeback. A military comeback, that is. These are changes in the political history again. There is a big struggle between Byzantium and the Arabs, military struggle. Between the 9th and the 11th century, what is forgotten in general historiography is that the Byzantines are winning these wars. And as a result, they reconquer parts of northern Mesopotamia in Syria. They retake the region of Antioch, and this creates a very close encounter between the 10th and especially the 10th, from the 9th onwards, I believe. But 10th and 11th century is a period of very close encounter that we have not, in modern historiography, paid attention to. It is the prequel to the Crusades. It never figures in official histories of the Crusades. It is a time of launched by the Byzantium during this time launches a program of re-Hellenization, if not linguistic, and at least cultural, among the peoples of this region that it has just reconquered in order to make sure it can stay there for longer. And this, I claim, generates a very close encounter between Byzantine and Arab culture. And what this claim changes in the reception of ancient Greek culture by Arabic civilization is, and that includes Homer, is the fact that the Greek-Arabic encounter of the 9th and 10th centuries has largely been imagined as recovering things from late antiquity as if from a deep freezer. The deep freezer is supposed to be the Christian monasteries that have remained in Muslim lands. And suddenly, Muslim intellectuals, with the help of Syriac speakers who also happen to know Greek, rediscover these manuscripts, again, manuscripts, and they start reading them and somehow discover that this is ingenious material and all of that. The taking into consideration the political reality that I described, this close military encounter that also must generate an intellectual encounter, makes us realize that this is cannot be like this. As in the case of the Cold War, that generated intense interest, let's say, in the Western world in Slavic studies and in getting to know the enemy, one can imagine something very equivalent in the 9th and 10th centuries and the 11th centuries. They become extremely interested in the science and the philosophy of one another. And what this means for Homer is an intensive interest on the Arabic side of the philosophical readings of Homer. This was the primary use, perhaps. So Homer in the Byzantine context was used as grammar, as an example of rhetoric, but it was also used as an interpretive method. It was used to, as an allegorical tool. So one read Homer, and there were three ways of understanding it. The ancient gods, it was a historical allegory, so the ancient gods and ancient rulers as allegories of historical figures. Then it was something called elemental, whereby they were understood, elemental allegory, they were understood as standing for the elements of the universe, such as planets, for example. So the ancient gods could be planets. And this has a very long history that starts already in antiquity, in pagan antiquity. Usually one thinks of allegory, I mean, as a way to Christianize, make palatable pagan texts. This is how one generally thinks of allegory. However, historians of philosophy well know that allegory is an intellectual tool already used by pagan thinkers in ancient pagan ancient philosophy. It is also used by Philo the Jew, a very eminent Jewish philosopher of the Hellenistic period, that was the source for a lot of Christianization of pagan notions within the Christian context, especially the Byzantine context. And so it has an intellectual history by the time the early Christian intellectuals take it into their hands. And it is a tool of interpretation and an approach that continues to be used in Byzantium in the 7th to the 9th century. My claim is we know very little about the Byzantine philosophical activity between the 7th and the 9th century, but we do see a 9th century, early 9th century Byzantine theological text mention this allegorical interpretation of the ancient gods as planets and then asking the question of whether the planets can have a soul. And this is in the context of discussing Byzantine iconoclasm, something I have no time to go into today. But what I'm trying to say is that this ancient interpretative technique of philosophical texts is used in order to answer the big philosophical and political problems of the day in early 9th century Byzantium. And it is I am convinced, and I don't have time to go through the evidence, that this is picked up on the other side of the frontier, because a few decades later, the person who is arguably the most famous among Greek to Arabic translators, a Syrian, an historian by the name Hunayn ibn Ishaq, uses this, uses allegorization in order to monotheicize his translation of pagan text. What does this mean? So let's say he translates Galen, and or he translates, we know, the second century AD dream book of Artemidorus. And in those texts occur mentions to the ancient gods. And it is a problem how to translate them for a medieval monotheistic society such as the one in which he lives. How can he make them understandable? So the tool he uses is allegory, and he renders their names with the names of the equivalent planets. And this is, so for example, the goddess Aphrodite is rendered as the planet Venus. God Zeus is rendered as the planet Jupiter. And this is clearly, of course, as I said, has an intellectual ancestry in already in antiquity. But again, I think it's part of this dialogue between the Byzantine and the Islamic world through Christian mediators during the 9th century. What is very interesting to mention in this context is that allegory became an extremely important philosophical tool in Islamic philosophy from the 11th century onwards. The big propagator of it within the Muslim world is, of course, Avicenna. And we have difficulty identifying the roots of its intellectual genealogy in the Islamic world. The earliest known example is the translation of Kalila Wadimna, which is a collection of tales that are a little bit like Aesop. And then they pop up in, this is an 8th century translation from Pahlavi into Arabic. And then we have them again in a 10th century text, very famous later in Islamic mysticism, the Letters of the Brethren of Purity, but we know of no 9th century example. And Honein's work and this dialogue that I say has happened between the two worlds is exactly this bridge in order to understand the development of allegory as a philosophical tool, because it happens exactly in this realm of philosophy. The most developed, perhaps, Islamic example of allegory in this vein, this I'll call it Greco-Roman vein, is in the work of the 12th century philosopher Suhrawardi, and he develops it. He's an ethnic Persian, and he develops a philosophical system using the pantheon of the Zoroastrian religion, not the Greco-Roman pantheon. So he creates a system of allegories whereby the gods of the Zoroastrian pantheon correspond to natural qualities like the gods of the Greco-Roman pantheon in the ancient and medieval tradition. And Suhrawardi does not really tell us where he gets his system from, but he says that his greatest teacher is not Avicenna, but Plato. And this is the only statement by which we can go. So he points us not to Islamic sources, but Neoplatonism of various hues. And it is exactly in this tradition of Plato that we get this this elemental allegorical interpretation. Now, this allegorical, this use of allegory within a Muslim philosophical system, in its turn, was known and understood by philosophers, both Byzantine and, so therefore Christian or former Christian and Muslim, at the court of Mehmed the Conqueror. And they used it for a philosophical discussion that included I will mention this very briefly. If you are curious, I will explain in the question and answer later. But they use this elemental allegorical system in order to develop magic and apocalypticism. So this is something that comes from very deep antiquity, transforms many, many times, but every time is reinvented in order to correspond to the needs of the day. It's never divorced from a social context. The in Orientalist, modern Orientalist literature, what exists in the way the influx of Greek material into Arabic has been approached was couched in terms of a question of origins. So the Greek was viewed as the origin of the Arabic, and the political implications for the colonial context was that Islamic civilization is a derivative civilization. Therefore, this could be understood as something derogatory with a modern political message that was very unwelcome. There was, within an Orientalist context, an effort to trace to use Arabic as a warehouse from which to retrieve Greek antiquity, like the Byzantine material had been used as a warehouse from which to retrieve Greek antiquity. And so there was an effort to identify mentions of Homeric material within the Arabic text and show it as Greek influence or Greco-Roman influence on Islamic civilization. Part of this chase included elements of Homeric stories, and perhaps the most famous such example is the story of the Cyclops, the one-eyed mongrel, that appears in Arabic and also in Turkish literature. In a spirit of revising older scholarly findings within a new political context that now no longer condones colonialism, the idea of an ancestry of these elements was dismissed in favor of a universal human standard. So the one-eyed mongrel as a locus communis occurring in world literature. And whereas one cannot but agree with this interpretation that it is something that recurs in human stories, at the same time, one has to ask about what motivates its dissemination, especially in civilizations that we know and literatures that we know came in close contact with one another. So my claim is that if one looks at the dissemination of elements of Homeric plots within Arabic literature, one finds that most of these elements, if not all of them, come from the Odyssey and not from the Iliad. This is not by chance, because the Iliad was used in the Byzantine context as a textbook for grammar, for more approaching language. And the Odyssey has a much longer, much more interesting reception in Neoplatonism and in allegory. The prime vehicle of this allegory is an understanding of the journey of Odysseus around the sea, etc., repatriation, as a story of the human soul that has to travel on its way to salvation. And in this tradition of Neoplatonist interpretation of the Odyssey, the one-eyed mongrel is the ugliness of human passions, that the philosophically trained soul for which Odysseus stands can protect himself from. So all of these narratives of that have Homeric elements repeat themselves in stories that have clearly a circulation in mystical circles in Islam. And the best known, I'll use the term, it's an umbrella term, it needs to be qualified. So Sufism, which is the best known form of Muslim mysticism, was very welcoming to all of these stories that have the Homeric element. And although we understand this as popular religion and as a local phenomenon, et cetera, one should never forget that it has a substratum in learned traditions, including a high-level understanding of a Neoplatonist tradition that we know was transmitted in Arabic, although we have no exact understanding of what exact texts were translated. For Aristotle, for example, we have a clear understanding of the transmission, but for Plato, we don't. And this is what leaves us uninformed, and I'm trying to make this connection and claim that it was helped by a Byzantine understanding of the Homeric texts and its elements and its allegorical interpretation, which was current in Byzantium at around the same time. The Muslim reception of Homeric elements was not ignorant of the importance that Homeric plots played in these narratives of identity that I mentioned earlier in the Christian world. And I will only mention one example. This is a Persian epic, which was probably written in Tarsus toward the end of the 11th, perhaps the 12th century. It is known as the Darabnameh, and it is attributed to an author named Tarsusi. We know absolutely nothing about his biography, except that the epithet Tarsusi indicates a connection with the city of Tarsus, which is right here. And we know nothing else about him. The earliest surviving manuscript is from India in the 16th century. It has many different versions. It has a very big reception in the Turkish world. There is a Turkish translation and different versions of it in Turkish. What is unusual about it compared to other Persian epics is that ethnic Greeks make an appearance that is a bit too frequent. Also, it has a geographical center in the Aegean islands. This is very weird. And this is not my idea. I completely have it because this, only excerpts of this have been translated in French. I don't read Persian. This is inaccessible to me. But I base what I'm telling you on an impression by Dick Davies, who is one of the foremost translators of Persian poetry into English right now, and a man very well educated in the classics. So he told me that although he has never translated the Darabnameh, reading it, he couldn't help thinking that there is very concrete instances where there is Homeric imagery used. For example, the hair, human hair, like it's a flower and it doesn't. Yes, exactly, thank you. Hyacinth, yes. So this struck him, and he didn't know how to explain it. And he could only explain it through Tarsus's connection with Tarsus, which in the 12th century changes constantly hands between Byzantines, Turks, Armenians. So, and Persian at this time is the court language of the various Turkish courts in Anatolia. So we have a Persian epic that is used as a Turkish legitimation story and makes concrete references to the Homeric epics because there is awareness of the importance of the Homeric epics within 12th century Byzantine education, which we know very well the case was. And since I'm running out of time, I have to move on to the modern period. So what I want to emphasize, to recapitulate from what I just said, is the importance of Homeric elements of Homeric stories as stories of legitimization within the genealogy and the historical vision of the world, and also the importance that Homer has for allegory, especially when reading technical literature, philosophical, and also astrological. This kind of reception, another dimension that the Homeric epics have within Byzantine education is as examples used for moral edification. And I have no time to analyze this, but it is a very strong characteristic, a very strong role that they play in Byzantine education. What I find extremely important is that at the end of the medieval, early modern period, we have a phenomenon completely unconnected to Byzantium. We have a translation of Sanskrit epics into Persian at the Mughal court. And the people who study the phenomenon now indicate that, so you have an equivalent problem. You have a pagan polytheistic text that needs to fit within a Muslim monotheistic context. And the way it is done is, again, by using some of the techniques that are used in the Byzantine context, which is understanding it as a form of wisdom literature, as an example for moral edification. Also identifying royalty with the ancient gods, as was done within the Byzantine context, both in the chronicle tradition and in the allegorical philosophical tradition. And also sometimes identifying the gods of the Indian pantheon with planets. So since these are not immediately communicating civilizations, one has to ask why. And the brief answer is that because both the Homeric epics and the Indian epics play a role, a political role, as legitimizing tools for ruling dynasties. They are part of a court literature, And within these equivalent environments, although the context in Byzantium is very different than the Mughal one, however, there's this equivalency of inviting the pagan ancient epics to play a role because they are known, because they are a form of vocabulary for articulating power that is circulating. Therefore, the need to integrate them and the technique of how to do it ends up being equivalent, not because they know one another, but because transformation corresponds to equivalent needs. So now we reach 1453, the conquest of Constantinople by the Ottoman Turks, and what happens is, we mentioned it earlier, there is a flight of intellectuals from Byzantium to Italy and elsewhere in Europe. And at the same time, of course, there is people of Greek education that remain in the Ottoman Empire. And for the next 400 years or so, the approaches to Homer that happen within and outside of the Ottoman Empire among people who can read Greek are somewhat different, but somewhat informed from one another. I want it registered that the allegorical interpretation, ancient gods as planets, the last that it is attempted, this is in the 16th century. There is a famous Hellenist at Tübingen, Martinus Crucius, who writes his own commentary on Homer. He wants to interpret, in the commentary, he wants to offer the elemental interpretation. And he interprets all the meetings of the gods described in Homer as conjunctions of planets. So he writes to Mestlin, and he writes to Kepler to astrologically calculate how, because Homer is the truth. And one has to astrologically calculate how it is possible for these, what does it reflect in the real history of astronomy and astrology. And as far as we know, Kepler responded jokingly that his teacher may want to do this, but he's too busy to do that because as a mathematical exercise is an incredibly, I mean, it's work for years. So he said, my teacher, if you want to do this, fine, but I'm not going to. And that's the end of hearing about that approach, but I use it because it also brings home the close connection between astronomy and astrology during the early modern period, and a way in which this use of Homer for reading technical literature, astronomical and astrological, could still be relevant. Of course, in the 16th century, there is 15th and 16th century, there is two things happening. Byzantinists well know, it is pretty patent to a Byzantinist, that 15th and 16th century receptions of ancient Greek education, or you know, the Schrifttum, is inscribed within a curriculum developed in Byzantium in the late Byzantine period. So the reading program of Europeans reading Greek and approaching the classics in the 15th and 16th century is very close to what Palaiologan intellectuals would have done, intellectuals of the late Byzantine period. And as a result, much of the readings that are offered within a European context in the 16th century are inspired from earlier such Byzantine readings or go against them. And this is also the fate of allegorical interpretation. Sometimes the same intellectual, European intellectual, will offer both readings, would appear to be both for and against allegory, depending on whom he's addressing. It's kind of an instrumentalist approach. You don't have to have a consistent attitude toward allegory. You use it differently depending with whom you are talking. Scholars of the Renaissance also agree that these approaches to Homer are either appropriations or reactions against Byzantine readings of Homer, but never ignoring them. A very influential view against allegorical interpretations of Homer was by Rabelais, who totally rejected them, but worse was yet to come. And that is toward the closing decades of the 17th century in the context of the Querelle des Anciens et des Modernes, that in general has a very critical stance toward the authenticity of texts. Of course, it's all about the Bible in the end, but other texts are allowed to come in, like ancient authorities, etc., etc., as part of the problem. So this begins to radically revise ways in which Homer had been read in the Byzantine period. Questions of authenticity, whether Homer had wrote everything that was attributed to him, like the war between the cat and mice, or the Homeric hymns, etc. These were problems known in the ancient world. The Byzantines knew them, which is why we know that they knew them in the ancient world. And so this is not a problem that was ignored. It was discussed within a Byzantine context, but it was not important. There was not the same emphasis on authenticity. What changes in the course of the querelle des anciens et des modernes and becomes even worse for the Byzantine material in the 19th century is a different understanding of what constitutes authenticity. So there is a blow in Byzantine receptions that don't have to do with grammar and grammatical analysis, etc., but an understanding of reading, of how you read Homer, as we said, during the querelle des anciens et des modernes. And of course, in the 19th century, we have the rise of historicism, criticism, Quellenkritik, a criticism of sources, and there is a complete rejection of what the Byzantines were doing. Also in the literary realm, in literary tastes, there is a radical change. The 18th and the 19th century reject allegory. It's something that they don't like. And I think the very reason that I'm able to stand in front of you and talk so long about allegory is that we are reacquiring a taste for it as we speak. I mean, there is a revival. I mean, within at least the Byzantine field and at least within my purview, I have seen a resurgent interest about the study of allegory within the last 10, 20 years, which definitely was not there before. There is, however, yet another use that is outside the rarefied world of intellectual activity and has completely to do with the political context of the 19th and 20th centuries. And this is the rise of nation states. And before the nation states, of course, exist, there has to be an ideological foundation, there has to be an intellectual preparation. And this already starts in the 18th century. So in the 18th century, and this is the last slide I will show, but maybe it's fun to show it. I'll stay with this one. In the 18th century, there is a rediscovery of, first of all, oral traditions. Oral traditions of medieval European vernaculars, and there begins a thinking about the role of literature and a national literature and the role it plays in order to constitute a nation state. This begins in the 18th century, culminates in the 19th. And within it, national literatures, of course, include epic traditions. And Homer's epic is understood already in the 18th century as a form of oral literature eventually written down. So if we understand that process, maybe we can model it on more recent oral traditions and medieval epics that we have written down, and we can use one in order to illuminate the other. The person who is primarily responsible, like the beginning of this line of thinking, is a French polymath. His name is Villoison. And at the same time as he approaches this, the text as oral tradition, he does not neglect the editing of texts. And he's the one that makes known to modernity this particular manuscript. It is the oldest known manuscript of the Iliad. It is known as Venetus A. So it is in the library in Venice. I'm not going to tell how it ended up there. It's complicated. But this is an extremely important manuscript because not only does it have the text of the Iliad, but it also has, it is a 10th century manuscript on the basis of its script. It was illustrated with these pictures that you see here. The woman in the middle is Helena, Helen of Troy. But these figures are not made to look like Helen of Troy would have looked like whenever the Trojan War took place, but she looks like a 12th century Byzantine queen, like a Byzantine empress. And it is because this manuscript has attracted so much attention for what it can tell us about ancient Homer, these pictures have received very little attention. So I do not, it has not been figured out how they fit within a 12th century political context, but it is very clear that this is where they fit. And of course the 12th century, as is well known to Byzantinists, is a period of importing Western princesses to Byzantium and making them fit within a Greek cultural context. And we know that for at least one, part of a Homeric commentary was prepared. So knowing your Homer was part of cultural transformation. In order to become a Byzantine empress, a Western princess would have to change her clothes, wear Byzantine clothes, change her name, and learn her Homer. So this must be part of that story, but art historians have not exactly, to the best of my knowledge, figured out how. This manuscript is brought to Venice, belongs to the Biblioteca Marciana today because it was owned by a very important Byzantine intellectual of the 15th century, Bessarion, who gave all his books to the Republic of Venice, and then these books became the core of the Biblioteca Marciana. And in the 18th century, it is read by Villoison, who understands its importance for the textual tradition of Homer, and eventually becomes the most important manuscript on which modern editions of Homer's text base themselves, because it is very good philologically and also the oldest known. But Villoison, as I said, is also the one who pays attention to Homer as a generator of, as an example, the Homeric poems as examples of oral literature. This has an extremely important reception in the Balkans and eventually also in other parts of the Ottoman Empire, because little by little, an approach to the ancient classics, as I explained at the beginning of my talk, are understood as cornerstones of a modern Western identity, only analyzed in a radically different way than what I've been explaining for the Middle Ages. And in this context of understanding Homer as a prime epic, the mother of all epics, there is an understanding also in various national movements for independence that their own national heroes active in the 19th century are modeling themselves after the Homeric heroes. A prime example that I like very much and I will briefly take time to tell you about is the most important hero, perhaps, of the Greek War of Independence in 1821 against the Ottoman Empire. His name is Kolokotronis. He was completely literate, as far as we know. He wrote his memoirs, but he couldn't write, so he had to dictate them to somebody who could write. But he identifies with Agamemnon. He says what a good leader he was. So there's a question of how on earth did he know about it? Well, he spent time on the Ionian Islands. There was a very educated man there. I'm not going to go into his story, but let's say it is through oral tradition. I mean, even if he couldn't read, there is oral information about all these things, and it helps his self-understanding. And another example I cannot resist is that of a woman. She was a very wealthy widow. So she built ships that she used in the War of Independence against the Ottoman Empire. She armed a particular one, a very formidable ship. She pretended that she was going to use it for commerce, but she absolutely intended it against the Ottomans, and she named that ship Agamemnon, the leader of the Greek army. I don't think the point can be missed. Except to someone who does not know the Homeric epic. So it's like a public but insider message or joke, if you will, that she's making. So all these people who really did not have a classics education, really did not have a highbrow education, know about these things because they circulate as part of an intellectual preparation for a war of independence. And a modern Greek state is created in 1830. There begin to be educational institutions. There is a first effort, one brings in a governor, this doesn't work out. And then a Bavarian king is imported, who comes in and brings also educational institutions modeled after the German ones. So there's an entire modern Greek educational institution that is very closely modeled after what was being done in Germany. There is heavy emphasis on the classics, and if one looks at the curricula, there is a radical change. Because if one looks at what of Homer was being taught up to the end of the 18th century, it included not just Homer, just a little bit of the two epics, the Iliad and the Odyssey, but very important was the war of cat and mice. This is completely obliterated from the curriculum now. It used to be paired with the church fathers, especially Gregory of Nazianzus. Now Gregory of Nazianzus is nowhere to be found. It is strictly classics, 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 absolutely before the second sophistic, before the Roman period. And so this is a very radical shift. There is also Neo-Homeric poetry that is composed. There is poetry in Homeric diction and meter that is composed in the middle of the Crimean War in order to comment on the Crimean War. I have no time to go into detail on that, but again, it is Homer brought into connection with political realities, and it is used in two ways. First, to teach the foreign king that Otto is about modern Greek spirit that goes back to the ancient classics, casting the heroes of the Greek Revolution after the heroes of Homer's epics, and also honoring the classical education that the German king brought with him. So this is another political point. We are around the middle of the 19th century. In the closing decades of the 19th century and the very first decade of the 20th, we have a remarkable but not so remarkable coincidence. This is the translation, these are the first translations of the Homeric epics into Balkan national languages. And we have, I refrain from giving names because I think I've already given you too much information. I'm happy to discuss names afterwards. There is a translation of Homer by an ethnic Albanian, first into Ottoman Turkish, directly from classical Greek. Around this time, there is other translations. There is a translation into Arabic that is done by a Maronite intellectual, Suleiman al-Bustani. It finishes in 1905, and it is done out of French and Italian translations. And I'll come back to him later. But this Albanian translates directly from classical Greek. And when the cause, because at this point he identifies as an Ottoman. But around the same time, there are discussions about Albanian independence. So a few years later, he's embittered with Ottoman politics vis-a-vis that. So he translates again, this time in Albanian. So it's the same person. The question is, how does he know so good classical Greek so he can translate? The key is he has attended a very famous institution, Greek nationalist institution, on Ottoman, at the time Ottoman territory, and this is the Zosimea Scholi in Yanina. This is a very well-known place. This is where he picks up not only knowledge of Homer, but an understanding of what epic poetry can do, and ancient epic poetry in dialogue with contemporary oral traditions for a national cause. So that's what he implements. Around the same time, we get a translation of Homer into Bulgaria. Well, it's complicated. I'll call it Macedonian, and this means the Slavic dialect that is spoken in what is the national territory of Bulgaria, the former Yugoslav Republic of Macedonia, and also Greece. So this, this man was educated in Greek. He had been a very good student, was very close to ethnic Greeks, composed original poetry in Greek, and won a a poetic competition held by the Greek state, writing in Homeric diction and the meter about a war of national independence in his native region around Ohrid. And after he received the prize, Greeks got very upset and the prize was withheld. So they took it back from him. He became very angry, and from that time on, he no longer identified, he didn't want to see the Greeks anymore, and he identified as Bulgarian. So I hesitate because both the Bulgarians and the Macedonians, the Slavic Macedonians, claim him as a father of their literature. So I don't want to take sides, but I want to offer a reality. And within the same chronological space, again, we have two translations into Serbian, and they are done by people with slightly different profiles. And all of this is testimony to the triumph of Greek educational institutions in the Southern Balkans under Ottoman territory in the closing decades of the 19th century, which is what enabled Greece to take over these territories as national Greek territory after 1912. Because urban, educated, Orthodox Christians, regardless of ethnicity, regardless of what they spoke at home, identified with the Greek education of which Homer was part. And the translators, the first translator into Serbian, first translates the War of the Cat and Mice that comes out of a Byzantine curriculum. So he doesn't pick it up from a Western framework. It's Homer as the Byzantines knew him. But he also goes on to translate the Odyssey in prose. And so he doesn't try to recreate meter like the other translators, but one has to guess what kind of statement this is, whether it is against identifying it with modern epic traditions, oral poetry, etc. But he clearly has an agenda. And this translator is ethnically an Aromanian or Vlach. These are also called Tsintsari, because of how they pronounce the number five. But this is a Romance, a group of Romance speakers in the Southern Balkans. These have no particular, they don't identify ethnically, but when they are urban, they identify as social class, education, professional status. So these are well-off southern people from the Southern Balkans with a Greek education, but don't ask for any other qualifiers. So it's a very, and Homer is used to articulate this urban educated identity. The other translator into Serbian is more clearly Serbian, I mean, identifies with the Serbian national cause, he views Homer not as in contradistinction. So both of these translators distinguish themselves from, differ from the identification of Homer with living epic traditions. So the second translator into Serbian insists that Homer is like Virgil. So rather than the conglomeration of several anonymous voices of oral poetry, he's an individual like Virgil. And this is very different than a very influential understanding of oral poetry articulated, it goes back to Villoison, as I said, but best articulated, Western understanding, but best articulated in the 1930s by Milman Parry and Albert Lord, who went and studied oral performances by performers in Yugoslavia, and then used their anthropological findings in order to illuminate the composition of the Homeric epics. I think it's time for me to come to a closure, although I haven't said everything I could have said. I've left out translations in Turkey, but I come to my concluding point, which is, and it's a repetition of an earlier point, we are at the moment where we are redefining what it means to be Western, East and West divisions are put into question, but then they come back with force in the political arena. In school curricula, there is a demand to do away with an older canon that includes the so-called Western classics and that includes Homer. But the risk we run if we discard all this, although it is in response to a political need or a political call, is to render our recent past into the middle of the 20th century unintelligible to us. And this would be tragic if it happens, not because I'm Greek and what it means for the Greek classics, but because of one's ability to understand, I don't know, the city of Berlin walking down Kudam or going to the different Baroque palaces or anything you like in European urban environment. I am not the only one. This is very, very usual in the last 15 or 20 years. We have turned as a natural reaction to this to Rezeptionsgeschichte. We try to illuminate how the ancient classics were read in other eras, different civilizations. I think because it helps us not discard this legacy and not give up the keys to our own very recent past, no matter what we think about Greco-Roman civilization being the cornerstone of our modern identity or not. It's simply about understanding our intellectual genealogy. Thank you for your patience.